Good morning to everyone. Today let's see what is a capacitor actually is, and also what is the science behind it, when charging and discharging of it. A capacitor is a vital device that stores electrical energy in an electric field, and are widely used as parts of electrical circuits, in many common electrical devices. When purchased new, the plus end is the longer terminal, and also the minus end is, usually marked on the cover. Shown here are high-voltage ceramic capacitors with 15,000 volts. When handling capacitors, extreme care must be taken, as these charged capacitors can release high voltage and current in a fraction of a second. On the right side you will see a normal capacitor used in motors, with markings of 25 microfarads plus or minus 5, and 450 volts AC. It means that this capacitor can handle in the range of 24 to 26 microfarads, since 5% of 25 is only 1.25 microfarads. 450 volts AC means that it is the maximum voltage this capacitor can handle, but it can be used to replace any capacitor with a voltage less than this maximum value. That means it can be used to replace a 380 volts or 400 volts capacitor, but not a 455 volts capacitor. Parallel plate capacitor is the basic capacitor, where you can understand the function of it easily. It typically has two metal plates held parallel to each other, and a thin layer of dielectric or non-conductive insulating material is placed evenly between these two plates. If you remove the cover of this condenser, you will see the inside like this. Here the positive and negative connections are marked, and you can also see the two metal plates with the thin dielectric. Let's now connect a battery to this parallel plate capacitor. Here the thin dielectric is widened to show its correct functioning. Two metal plates were also widened, and you will see that the negatively charged electrons join with the positive charge to keep it neutralized. The molecules of the non-conducting dielectric also have a negative and positive charge, but they are distributed unevenly, since they are not influenced by the neutralized molecules on the conductive plates. When switch is closed, electrons start to flow from the top plate to positive side of the battery, and also electrons from negative side of the battery continue to flow and accumulate at the bottom plate. Normally current takes opposite path of the electrons, that is from positive end to the negative end. Also keep in mind, dielectric does not allow any current to flow through it. The flow of electrons will continue until the voltage between the plates equals the voltage difference of the battery. Since the neutralized molecules do not affect the charge of the plates, they can be removed now. When neutralized charge had been ignored, there will be positive charge on the top plate and negative charge on the bottom plate. The previous irregular pattern in the dielectric molecules will also now change to an organized pattern. Positively charged plate attracts the negative side of the dielectric molecules, and the pattern continues like this. Conductive plates on top and bottom hold equal and opposite charge between its surfaces now, thus developing an electric field within the dielectric material. Although an electric field develops within the dielectric, it will not allow current to flow through it as explained above, but it maintains a good charge between two plates. The capacitor is now charged and has the same voltage difference between the two plates as the battery. Even if you remove the battery now, capacitor is with its stored charge between the plates. Let's connect an electrical bulb to the charged capacitor now. When the light bulb is connected, electrons begin to flow from the negative end of the capacitor to the positive end and neutralize the positive charges it contains. Electric field between the plates inside of the dielectric starts to fade away now, and the voltage difference too falls back to zero. The brightness of the bulb will also dim down to zero level. This happens until the capacitor is completely discharged. A fully discharged capacitor will remain in neutralized state till it is recharged again. Let's see how the capacitance of a capacitor is defined. Mark V as voltage across the capacitor. D is the thickness of the dielectric measured in meters. Q is the stored charge measured in coulombs. Also, E is the electric field measured in volts per meter. Unit measuring the capacitance is given as farad. Since farad is a comparatively large unit, for ease of reference we usually take the value of microfarad, or even smaller units to show capacitance. For an example, 25 microfarad is 25 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 6 farad, or 0.000025 farad. Then the capacitance can be given by the equation, capacitance equals stored charge on it, divided by voltage across the capacitor. If you know the stored charge of a capacitor in coulombs, divide it by the voltage across the capacitor, to get the capacitance in farads. Further, you can get the capacitance by physical means of the used material, and you need to know about the permittivity then. Permittivity is commonly symbolized by the Greek letter epsilon. Permittivity is the ability to polarize through the dielectric, or simply, how much polarization is being permitted through it. It differs from material to material, and the unit is measured by farad per meter. Then the capacitance is equals to permittivity of the dielectric multiplied by square area of the metal plates and divided it by thickness of the dielectric. If you know the square area of the two metal plates and both the permittivity and the thickness of the dielectric, then the capacitance can be calculated from the given equation. Further, electric field inside of the dielectric can be derived from the given equation. So, the electric field equals voltage across the capacitor divided by thickness of the dielectric. I hope you now have a good understanding of capacitors and the science behind them while charging and discharging. If this video is useful, please subscribe to the channel. Thank you.